नफ्स दे सूफी इन द टायर और द साइको स्पिरिचुअल सेंटर पार्ट 3. नफ्स इज ऑलवेज इंटरेस्टेड इन कंटेंट्स. नफ्स loosely translated into English is ego self. The content that you can fill your consciousness with, that is what nafs is interested in. The content may be money or food or knowledge or something else, but nafs is interested in contents, whatsoever nature may be. However, after tamba, after the turning in, one becomes interested not in the contents but in the consciousness itself. Tamba is the first stage when you have started turning within. And once you have turned within, you are no more interested in contents. Instead, your interest becomes consciousness. What is this inner emptiness that you want to fill? First see it, know it, first become acquainted with it. First have a real taste of it, have a bite of it and chew it and see whether it is something to be filled or something to be enjoyed. And the moment you have taste of it, then everything you have tasted before will look worthless. This emptiness is fullness itself. This inner emptiness is the greatest joy that one can imagine. It is benediction. First, you have halls or altered states of consciousness. Sometimes these may come like flashes, but then it has disappeared and you have fallen back into misery again. All of a sudden, you are feeling very elated. Next moment, that state is altered. This is what is called flashes or halls. So it happens in the beginning like this, and once it has disappeared, you have fallen into misery again, deeper than before. If you do not create a nafs for whenever there is this situation comes, you do not create an ego sense about it, you start talking about this, there is less possibility disappearing or you falling back into that state of misery again. If you do not create the ego sense for these altered states, there is a possibility that you may start hankering for more. But then you have fallen back, then you have turned back again. Again you have created a horizon, and once again the mind comes in, and again there is desire in nature. Remember it, to many people, these altered states happen, and when this happens, you have a taste of a state that you have never experienced before. You want to desire it more. You become very desirous. A great longing arises in you how to have it every day. I can understand. It is so beautiful. It is such a benediction that one would like to have it. But if you start expecting, desiring, you will miss even the altered states or halls. I can understand, it is so beautiful. It is such a benediction that one would like to have it. But if you start expecting, desiring, you will miss even those states which are known as altered states or halls, or in Zen terminology, satoris. Means these come like a lightning. All of a sudden, a state comes, you feel very happy. Next moment, it disappears. It is quite natural that you want to have it more and more. Even these flashes like lightning will disappear, and these moments will be no more. Such states can happen only when nafs is no more there. If you enjoy the altered state and do not become desirous of it at all, instead feel grateful that it has come, then it is certain that these moments will come again and again. The moment you desire, these things do not happen. Remember, these are the stages. You are going to a particular concert, but along the way there are many attractions and you get lost into those attractions and you miss the final destination. These are the various stages. Then comes the fourth stage. Gurdjieff calls the fourth state is important. Like for instance, when I mentioned whenever any circumstance and situation comes, we naturally reject it or we remain unhappy. This is a state of pessimism. You have to move from this, choosing it consciously, knowingly, willingly, that you will try to be happy under all circumstances and situations. It will start becoming, in the beginning it will come like a flash. Then you are supposed to remember that you have to choose happiness in that particular moment. But you forgot, the state disappeared. You have fallen back into your misery. Then you again remember and you choose happiness. So these stages come and go. But when you choose to be happy, this is positive state. But then that is not the end. You have to discard everything along the path. These are like a resting moment. You are on a long voyage. You have driven about 2 hours. You need a rest. So you stop at a resting place. You take a rest. Then you continue your journey along the path again. So these are like that. And you may find that there are some of the resting places may be more beautiful than the other. So if you get lost into it, you will forget about your destination. So then comes the fourth state. The fourth state, there is something beyond happiness also, but you cannot envision how can there be something beyond happiness. Why have this man left this happiness? I have heard there was a poor woodcutter who used to go into the forest and he will cut wood, and by selling the wood he used to make his living, but he was very poor. One day while he was going to the forest, he saw a Sufi sitting down there and he asked the man that you cut wood. He said, yes, I am a very poor man. He said, if you go a little deeper than where you normally cut the wood, there is a copper mine. So first he did not believe, then he believed and he went in. When he went, he found the copper, he started mining the copper, and with that his life changed, his financial situation improved. Continued for some time, then one day again he saw the Sufi sitting there. He said, life is very happy now because he is mining copper. He said, you know, a little lower, if you dare to go in, there is a silver mine. A little further and he saw the silver mine and he started mining silver and selling it. A couple years after, again he saw the Sufi sitting there. He said that a little deeper there is a gold mine. If you go there, you can start extracting gold. So he went and he started dealing in the gold. Then again after a couple years, he saw the man sitting while as he was going the area to mine the gold. He said, a further lower down there is a diamond mine. We should go there. So he went and he found the diamonds. He started trading in diamonds. A couple years after, he saw once again the Sufi sitting there. He said, there is still a mine lower than that. And do you know that I know about all these mines and yet still I never went there? Because I know there is something beyond the diamonds also, the diamond mine. I have discovered that. And that's why I am not attracted to these copper, silver, gold and diamond mine. This is the way when you are traveling along the path, these temporary resting places comes, you have to go beyond. Beyond the, what can be beyond unhappiness is happiness. And what can be beyond happiness? A state of neutrality where neither you are bothered about happiness nor about sorrow. You are beyond both happiness and unhappiness, pain and pleasure. This is the state of neutrality. Or this is the middle path that Buddha emphasized. But in order to reach to that middle path where there is, that is beyond duality, is known as. For that state to attain, you have to lean to either side. You have to be a tightrope walker. You are leaning to the left and leaning to the right occasionally to be in the middle, to remain on the tightrope walking. That state is known as the fourth. Gurdjieff's method was that of the fourth state. Now comes the fourth state. Halls become permanent, and this is called magama. It means that one has arrived. Then it is always there. Then it is not that it happens to you. Instead, now you are in it. You are part of it. From nafs to magma. This is the journey of a Sufi. And the whole journey consists of experiments or experience. It is existential. You have to go a little deeper into the details of the states of nafs, because more you are acquainted with it, the more there is a possibility of tamba or conversion or repentance to come to you. Or that great leap or change of direction is necessary. There are three kinds of sleepy states of the people in this world. It is said that man is asleep, but are all men asleep in the same way? No, they are not. Everybody is asleep, but there is a difference in sleep too, and the difference is very significant. The first category of sleep is that of hostiles. They are asleep. They are asleep in their anger, rage, hostility, hatred, violence, aggressiveness, and in their ambition. This is the first kind of sleep, and that is of the hostile. You will see people around, the hostile people is very apparent. He is always angry about everything. He is destructive. He wants to destroy everything. The hostile can become revolutionary Mao, Stalin, Lenin. They want to destroy. They want to destroy the whole past. They want to destroy the whole society, of course. When you want to destroy, you cannot destroy as a pure air. You have to give it a utopia to people's mind like an opium. All utopias are opium. You have to tell them, we are going to change society for a better state. That is why we are destroying, otherwise nobody will support you. You have to create a dream. When you create the dream, people become infatuated with the dream, then you can destroy. That beautiful society never comes. It has never happened. And it is never going to come. This is why a man like Buddha never talks about the society. No social revolution is going to happen. Who is going to do it? The hostiles will do it. They are really interested in destruction. The idea of creating a better society is just a strategy to destroy without any guilt. The hostile person is one extreme. His anger is not particularly directed towards something. He is simply angry about everything. He is angry, and that is his nature. He has no object of anger. Everything and everybody seems to be inimical to him. Not only persons, but things look inimical towards him. He is inimical That is why the whole existence looks to him inimical. His basic attitude is negative. His sleep is very, very angry sleep. One thing is good about him. He is not cold. He is really burning, boiling deep within. He can be changed more easily than the other two kinds because he is hot. His fire is alive, but only wrongly directed. But the direction can be changed. He has power. If his direction is changed, and if his anger becomes a fuel for inner transformation, it is not just a coincidence that great masters in India came from the warrior race, would have produced more enlightened people because they are well versed logically, philosophically, in everything. They are good people, but they have not produced many enlightened ones. Buddha was a warrior, so was Mahavir, and so was other Jain masters like Adinath, and all the 24 apostles of Jain path, that is the path of Mahavir, they came from the warrior clan. Jains, Buddhas, Ram, Krishna, Nanak, they are all of the warrior clan. They have come from the warrior race. It is not just accidental. When a hostile person changes, he can become a Buddha very easily. So this is the best kind of sleep, the hostile sleep. This is why the work of the master consists first of making you hot through encounter, through other cathartic meditations. The whole point is to create more fire in you, to bring your hostility to the surface. Only from there is a possibility for change.